Hello everyone, this is Pattu from freefincal, and in this video let's talk about what is the best way to invest in the Nifty Next 50 index. Now in the previous videos, when I've talked about index investing, many people have asked me, why do you keep saying index funds are better than ETFs? At least the Indian index funds are better than Indian ETFs. Why, everywhere I've heard about ETFs being low cost and better than index funds, why do you keep saying that? So I will explain why I prefer index funds to ETFs in this video, and in the next video where we'll talk about the tracking error of index funds and ETFs. But we will do that with the Nifty Next 50 as an example. And so the Nifty Next 50 is essentially the 51st to 100th stock in terms of the free float market capitalization of all stocks on the National Stock Exchange. So it is the, so if you take the top 100 stocks in terms of free float market capitalization, the Nifty 50, which is the most popular index called the, just the Nifty, comprises of the top 50 stocks, and the Nifty Next 50 comprises of the bottom 50 stocks. And the reason why Nifty Next 50 has become popular is that many actively managed funds struggle to beat the Nifty Next 50. Although the Nifty Next 50 is not a large cap mutual fund, its risk is more like a mid cap fund. Many multi cap mutual funds and even many mid cap funds have struggled to beat the Nifty Next 50. And that is the reason why it makes sense for people who like index funds to have some allocation of Nifty Next 50 in their portfolio. Of course, it's a pretty volatile index, so be careful. So in the link just below, you will see all the resources on Nifty Next 50 from freefincal. So I suggest you read that and make a decision about that. So, but let's now look at what are the Nifty Next 50 index funds and ETFs available. So we have about 8 of them, and let's eliminate straight away the SBI ETF, which was just started in September 2018. I think it's too early to decide whether it's worth investing or not. You will know what I mean by that in the next slides. We will also eliminate the ICICI Nifty Next 50 ETF, again for the same reason, it's just too young. We will also eliminate the IDBI Nifty Junior Index. Nifty Next 50 is also called the Nifty Junior Index. It was that's the previous name, the old name. So the IDBI Nifty Junior Index has the direct plan has an expense ratio of 0.56%. That's too high. So let's eliminate that as well. And we look at the rest. So let's look at SBI ETF Nifty Next 50 fund. This has got an expense ratio of 0.23%. Now that looks very enticing to many people. They think that just because the expense ratio is lower, the tracking error will be low and so on. That's a very big mistake. The reason is that in an ETF, you are not directly interacting with the AMC. You are buying and selling units from other unit holders in the secondary market. Therefore, the price at which you buy will not be the NAV. In an index fund, the price at which you buy will always be the NAV of the index fund. And the prices which you sell will be the NAV. Here in an ETF, the price will be different. It will depend on the supply and demand in the secondary market for that particular ETF. Now, this is the price minus NAV by price. So that is the percentage difference or the percentage variation of the price from the NAV. And that's plotted for this ETF. Notice there have been some occasions where the where the price has deviated as much as 8-10%, but overall it's been okay. It's been close to 0%. Ideally, the price will deviate, but it should not deviate for too long. It should deviate both on the positive side and the negative side. So that is a good indication that the authorized participant or an intermediary appointed by the ETF is or the AMC is taking care of the liquidity in the mutual fund. I've explained that in another post. I'll also, you can see the link in the description box. So the key is that if you actually zoom it up a little bit, notice that the deviations, typical deviations, are not too much, it's about 0.5% on either side. That's very important. The ETF should not be found, the price of the ETF should not be always found above the NAV or below the NAV for extended periods of time. If it moves above the NAV, it should quickly come down. If it moves below the NAV, it should quickly move up. So it should oscillate up and down. That's quite fine. I think this is quite decent for a ETF, and that's this is fine. So as an ETF, this is quite fine, but can we do better is a question that we should ask. There's another ETF by UTI, and if you look at that, its expense ratio is just a little bit lower than the SBI one. But look at the period here. So if you notice here, this central region there, I hope you can see me circling the mouse. See that that's for like almost 2 months, the NAV has been, the price has been above the NAV. That's not good. You can't have that kind of departures. That means that there's a problem with the liquidity, and that means it's difficult to find buyers or difficult to find sellers for extended periods of time. That's not good. It's okay to find, it's okay for momentary departures, and that's inevitable, but it should quickly correct. And it's like a pendulum. Just think of a pendulum. If the price moves up, you know, because of inertia, it'll just move move below the NAV and just move up back and forth. So it should be like a pendulum. It should move above and below the NAV, and that's always healthy. If it stays on one side, it's not a good thing. So this is, I would avoid this ETF. So now let's look at the two popular choices, the Reliance ETF Junior Bees. This is the oldest ETF. It's more than 10 years old, if I recall. And the ICICI Nifty Next 50 Index Fund. Now, what we're going to do is we are going to compare, first of all, the returns over every possible 3 year periods of the ETF NAV versus the index fund NAV. Now, one big problem with ETF reporting is that people compare, people calculate returns using the NAV, and people calculate tracking error using the NAV. Whereas the investor will actually, the return the investor will get will be based on the price and not the NAV. The tracking error that the investor will see will be depending on the price and not the NAV. So do not trust any of the returns that you see in the ETF. You have to actually calculate it with the price data and find out the returns. So I will tell you how, what a big difference this makes. Now, if you use the ETF NAV versus the index fund NAV and calculate for 659 3 year periods in the past, you would find that the index bet the ETF about 98% of the time. So the index fund, the ICICI fund, bet the Reliance ETF. It was previously part of Goldman Sachs. It bet the ETF 98% of the time. And of course, the ETF will always be a little more volatile. That's what you see in the bottom graph. That's the rolling risk. So the higher values means higher risk. In the top graph, you see the rolling returns. They're all 3 year returns. There's not much difference. So the ETF will always be a little more volatile than the index fund. That's because of the price fluctuations, but that's not a problem. So don't worry about the rolling risk. I just did it. I like showing both, so I just did it. So don't worry about rolling risk in this video. So notice this, it's 98% of the time the index bet. Now let's look at again, 5 years, the index bet the ETF all 170 times. Right? If you look at the ETF NAV, it looks as if the index fund is better. But now let's look at the ETF price. The index fund bet the ETF only 67% of the times. So that's not bad. So you should always calculate it with the ETF price and not the ETF NAV. Although it is, even though the point I'm trying to make is that there are two points, hope you don't get confused. There are 2 points. One is always calculate returns with the ETF price and not the NAV, because price is what you're getting. The second, do not assume that just because an ETF has got low expense, it means it is better than the index fund. That is not true at all. In this comparison, we have not considered any demat account charges and brokerage and so on. But even then, even though the Reliance ETF has got a lower expense ratio than the ICICI direct plan, let me quickly check. So if I remember, Just a second. So let me just ICICI fund has got an expense ratio of 0.4%, the direct plan. The Reliance has got an expense ratio only half of that, if I remember right, or even less than half of that. So even though the Reliance ETF has got a lesser expense ratio, the index fund is still able to beat the ETF 67% of the time. That's quite significant. So do not assume lower expense means higher returns. That's not always true. Because of the market forces, you'll always get a slightly different result. Now for 5 years, again with the ETF price versus the index fund NAV, the index fund has had a higher 5 year return of 73% of the time. So that's very important to consider. Now the reason why I prefer index fund is, now first of all, do not assume, again like I said, higher expense does not mean poor performance. Second, in an index fund, you don't have this problem of having to sell to other people. You can happily buy from the AMC and sell from the AMC. Of course, all that said, the Reliance Junior Bees is a good choice for all people who are already having DMAT accounts. So notice that that I have not included the DMAT account charges, the brokerage, etc. So the performance will be a bit less, but it doesn't matter. It's just a very small difference. But if you're comfortable with the DMAT account, if you know how to buy and sell ETFs, market order and limit order, if you know those distinctions, if you know how to sell properly in a DMAT account or buy, then you can do it. There's no problem. But if you don't, you don't need to open a DMAT account just for investing in ETF, just for tracking the index. The index funds are much better, in my opinion. And the ICICI fund has, like I said, it's about a 0.44% expense ratio. The UTI Nifty Next 50 has just opened. It's just about a few months old. But it has already raked up quite a significant AUM, and its AUM and its expense ratio is only 0.27%. So I think that's a very good choice right there. Of course, it depends. The fund manager of the UTI may not be able to handle the tracking error as well as the ICICI fund manager has done. That's something that one needs to check. But if you look at it purely from the expense ratio, among index funds, wins, in my opinion. But the ETFs are also not so bad. I mean, that's at least this ETF. So the point is that this is the reason why I prefer index funds to ETF. One, you should be careful. You should look at the liquidity. The price data is not readily available. You have to extract it and then study it, and then only make a choice whether that ETF is right for you or not. Don't go by tracking errors that you see. We will discuss this in the next video. Do not go by expense ratios. You'll have to actually analyze the liquidity using the price and NAV difference and then make the decision. If the price NAV deviation is not too much, then and only then the ETF is a good choice. So I'll catch you again in another video. Bye-bye.